morning. I'm so excited to bring you another dose of hope this morning. Something that's been on my mind a lot lately is rest. And all through this season, I've just been like continually rest has been brought up in my spirit. And a couple Sundays ago, we came in and I could feel like this tangible fatigue in the room and that people were carrying. And I know I'm carrying it too. It's like this physical, emotional, and sometimes even spiritual exhaustion right now with all that's going on. There's so much unrest and restlessness. It's hard to keep our hearts in a place of rest. So, you may have heard this growing up or even, you know, in science or whatever. Newton's law, an object in motion remains in motion and an object at rest remains at rest unless acted on by an outside force. So today I want to invite you into a place of rest, how to live from a place of rest and remind you, if you need reminded, and I'm reminding myself too, to not let anything outside move you from this place of rest. To live from a place of rest is to live from the understanding that what I produce from my own ability won't bring me the peace that comes when I live in response to His ability. Okay? And this is the life that Jesus exemplified. I only do what I see the Father doing. He said that many times. So our only responsibility is to respond to His ability. Doesn't that take the weight off? It's like, okay, what is His ability? Well, He's able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine. And with God, all things are possible. So this is simple, right? In Hebrews 4:9, we're talking here about the Israelites, and he's offering this rest to us now again. There remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God, for anyone who enters God's rest also rests from their work just as God did from his. Referring to creation, on the seventh day he rested. And it says, therefore, make every effort to enter into that rest so that no one will perish by following their example of disobedience. So that the example of disobedience comes from the Israelites while they're walking through the desert. God's leading them out of Egypt into the promised land. And there's miracles happening daily, things that are happening that should increase their likeliness to believe in the faithfulness of God, but somehow they have missed it the entire time. And I look at what he brought them through. If you go back and read Exodus 2 and just watch all the miracles that God laid out for them and how easy he tried to make it for them to get to the land of promise. And they were just continually in unbelief. And I think, man, were they blind? Did they not see it? And then I take a look around and I consider my responses to the things that I'm seeing right now. And I think, oh, I'm sorry, God, help my unbelief. You know, I don't want to be like that. I feel like they're constantly my example for like believing in God and what he's saying and what he's doing. So a few weeks back, I was scrolling through Facebook and I stumbled upon, I was already kind of like losing faith, losing my good attitude, and I saw this picture. And it was a boy being baptized on the same corner that George Floyd was killed. And immediately the word undercurrent dropped into my heart. I had this like hope and this excitement and this expectation. And so the word undercurrent, an underlying feeling or influence, especially one that is contrary to the prevailing atmosphere and is not expressed openly. This isn't something that most people would see if they weren't looking for it. A current, the second definition, a current of water below the surface moving in a different direction from any surface event. I don't know about you, but this excites me. This idea of, hey, you know what? This is what it looks like on the surface. There's turmoil, yes. There's pain, there's all this stuff, but look a little deeper. He's calling us to the deeper because there's this movement and it's a powerful force and it's pulling people into the ocean of his goodness. Come on, that's what an undercurrent does. We're afraid of it because it's gonna pull us out, and you know, if you don't know how to fight it or go with it, actually, you don't wanna fight it, you wanna go with it, you can end up in a really bad spot if you try to fight it. So it's pulling him into this ocean of his goodness. And I feel like that's just like, that's exciting to me. That's like, gives me hope, it gives me peace. And I feel like God is saying, this is what I want you to rest on. This is God's ability. This is what he can do. Only God can take a place of death, of pain, of shame and destruction and turn it into redemption and life. That's what's happening right now. I pray, God, open our eyes to see, you know, because when we work from our own ability, we will only produce that which we can produce. But when we live in rest, in response to his ability, the result will be exceedingly and abundantly more than we could have ever made on our own or asked or imagined, right? So today, I just wanna take a moment and just declare this rest over you, this place of rest over your thoughts, over your hearts, over your health, over your finances, over everything that you put your hand to, that you would just live in response to the good news and the gospel, and that in every area that God would show you, there's creative ideas right now for all of those areas, for your health, for your finances, for your thoughts. There's all these things that we can do and that God wants to show us how to do. I know for me, like something that I feel like an area that I'm continually like striving in, which is the opposite of rest, is with health and just finding that balance of like, what am I doing to continually be healthy? And I feel like I have a lot of tools and I have a lot of stuff, but I'm like, God, what am I missing? What can I do? And I felt the two things was, okay, stop sugar and drink water. And that's so simple, but why is it so hard? And so that's the one thing that I'm constantly like trying to find peace in this area of like, okay, all I need to do is what I'm doing and add this to it, you know? But it's all of us have our areas that we need his guidance and we need his help to find that place of rest and to find that place of peace and that balance, because that's what we are created for. And that's what we are created to give and show to this world is peace and rest. So I want to end with this scripture from Matthew 11, 28 to 30. Are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion, on your works, on your striving? Come to me, get away with me, and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. So I pray today that you would find rest in all that you are doing, and that God's peace would overshadow all of the chaos and all of the turmoil, and that we would trust and be confident in what he is doing right now, and that we would know what our part is. So, because rest isn't an inactivity. It's, but it's partnering with who he is and what he's called us to do. So Father, I speak life and rest over your people today in Jesus' name, amen.